Hello, everyone. Welcome to Art and Its Reasons, Retooling the Horizons of Practice seminar with Diann Bauer and Patricia Reed. I'm more than happy to start this seminar. This is our first studio seminar at the new center. Diann and Patricia not only are practicing artists, but they're also members of a collective of thinkers called Xenofeminism. And they both have writing practices and art practices. And just to introduce the course, I would read a couple of sentences from the course description. This seminar will introduce a diagnosis of contemporary art that challenges several dominant and ideal narratives endemic to the field, addressing the chasm between what many want contemporary art to do, what many say contemporary art does, and how contemporary art actually operates. So without more delay, I'm going to pass on the microphone to either Diann or Patricia. I don't know which one wants to start first.
So I will start. So I'm Patricia, and you'll hear from Diann shortly. So I'd just like to welcome all of you for joining you here today. Basically this is the first class of Art and Its Reasons, Retooling Horizons of Practice. So I'm just going to read a little brief intro that's going to kind of like map out what we'll be doing throughout the course and how it's going to be structured. So basically this is a theme of interest for both of us that emerged largely with regard to theoretical developments under the rubric of neo-rationalism or left accelerationism, a category that foregrounds pragmatics in the Peircean sense, epistemological navigation, and certain scalar imperatives that fundamentally challenge the dominant narrative or legitimization of contemporary art as a de jure space of freedom, insofar as it fosters conditions of subjectivization in the viewer as an emancipatory vector in and of itself. This class is intended to be an experimental step in exploring the ramifications of this discourse upon the field of contemporary art, or as our guest tonight, or today for most of you, would say, why that category needs to be destroyed. Since the key implication of a neo-rationalist position includes not only knowing or thinking, but more importantly, the emergent behaviors or material follow-throughs based on commitments to that plastic knowing, namely ethics, it seems particularly urgent for us to apply this to our own field as practitioners. So it's rather easy to be cynical about the field of contemporary art, given its particular claims, what it says it does vis-a-vis what it actually does. This gaping chasm between contemporary art's idealisms, what we dream it to paraphrase Suhail, our guest tonight, and its reality indexes a movement of disavowal indicating an ethical deficit at work in our field, requiring both honest appraisal and a demanding reconfiguration axiomatically if art is to participate in a world-forming program for post-capitalist change. These demands are unabashedly grandiose, unachievable by a singular artist, work, or institution. Nor will we fully answer to them in this humble seminar, but they're undeniable problematics that cannot be ignored in our field, a field that seems increasingly buttressed by faith-based pillars of sheer idealisms. With that in mind, Art and Its Reasons will play with the double signification of the title. So on the one hand, we'll work on the foundational reasons for art. Why does this category of distinctly human production need to exist? And how new logics of operation, its axiomatics again, could function anew? And on the other hand, how the category of art participates in the construction of rationality, beyond the rather empty and rampant signifier that goes under the name of knowledge production. So in the spirit of transparency and being explicit, it's fair to say we see ourselves, so Diann and myself, as moderators of ideas rather than experts with a fully formed thesis to be taught. So we'll be navigating this terrain alongside developing footholds of conceptual traction along the way with all of you. We've arranged for four sets of guests throughout the session who have already worked extensively on some of the problems we've just mentioned. So tonight we'll have art theorists, and I suppose now officially a finance theorist as well, Suhail Malik, with us, who will help us to map out the diagnostics of our field, and who will introduce in a moment. The second week, we're going to have artist and writer Amanda Beech, with whom we'll discuss the synthesis between the image and the structure of the real. In the third week, we'll be examining stereoscopy, entrapment, and escape through the work of artists and writers Keith Tilford and Joshua Johnson, whom you may already be familiar with from the Fixing the Future group. And our last guests on the fourth week include members of the largely Parisian-based Glass Bead Collective, through which to introduce concepts of gluing art with rationality as a transmodern project. So structurally, we'll spend the first around sort of 90 minutes with our guests, delving right into the work with the assumption that everyone's done the readings. And then we'll proceed in a dialogue or interview format, after which we'll open things up to sort of a group discussion. And as the first, as so Mo mentioned, the first sort of digital studio seminar at the New Center, the fifth week will be a session of participant-driven presentations. So given the constraint of the online format, the presentation should be conducive to screen viewing. So something like screen sharing or work that can be delivered via URL, like images, video, sound, and that sort of thing. But I think it should be stressed that since we're dealing with the broad systemic questions concerning art, its logic, rather than exclusively highlighting specific practices, these so-called outputs could take on a wide variety of forms, not necessarily like art projects. So they could be something like alternative models of distribution, modes of reception, alter institutional schematics, and so forth. And so with that, I think Diann and I, before jumping on to Suhail, it would be really great to just get a sense of what everyone's sort of like mini biography is, what your role is as practitioners or theorists and that sort of thing. So I'm not sure if you want to take over from Diann and just sort of initiate some sort of...
Well, I'd like to get a sense of... originally, when we looked at the course, it was a question of... This is a more technical question of, like, there's people who audit and people who register fully and was sort of dependent on numbers. So I'd like to get a sense of... We were just going to do... like studio reviews of those that are fully registered. I would, one, like to get an idea of numbers for that, but also there may be ways sort of to just have larger conversations about individual concerns. I'm not sure how many of us are all involved, but basically we could just go through, I'm not sure the best way to do it. Mo, do you have an alphabetical list of people by any chance?
There's an alphabetical list shared with you. It's a spreadsheet document on Google Doc that you can see who is registered and who is auditing and all that.
No,
I can tell you there's
you have it there in order for people to go in.
But before getting into that, I just wanted to say that the sidebar here is really good for side conversations. If people have links and stuff, they can put it in a sidebar. Some of the stuff that comes up in the middle of your conversation can be pasted there, and then you guys can pick it up as a question or as a point of discussion or something. I already posted like something there that for those who don't really like have a good idea of like how to begin to sort of like relate acceleration and irrationalism and all that. I posted the link from my talk at the New Museum to the sidebar, and you guys can add stuff to it like the manifesto or like other stuff. But yeah, I'm gonna share the list with you. In one sec, as you go through, I'm just gonna like email it to you and to Patricia, so you guys can see the list. There, I think about 6 registered students, and the rest are audits.
Okay, I mean, it would nonetheless be good to get a sense of who of what everyone's where it was coming from, and anyway, regardless of their status.
Start from Samil or somebody who wants to volunteer and start talking. I think it would be good if everyone kind of like introduced themselves quickly. So
yeah, Yeah. So, okay, I don't have a list to hand. If anyone just wants to jump in and start,
okay, Samuel, why don't you
go in whatever order.
Okay, my name is Samuel Molina. I'm from Grand Rapids, Michigan. I went to Kendall. I got my bachelor's in art history there in 2011. Right now I'm a grad student starting in the fall doing my master's in visual and critical studies. And right now just started with doing the certificate program in art and curatorial practice. My philosophical background is actually, I'm pretty much a newbie, so I'm just trying to absorb as much as I can and just go through it. But yeah, that's my background right now.
Thank you.
I'm Manuel. I'm from Mexico, and I'm a translator. And right now I'm translating a book by Armen Avanesian, Speculative Drawing, into Spanish. Yeah, I finished my master's at the European Graduate School this August. Yeah, nice to meet you.
Thank you, Manuel.
Great.
Christina, I see you. Don't hide out there.
Oh, hi. Hi, Patricia.
Hello.
Nice to see you live. Yeah. Well, I didn't really want to speak because I'm just an auditor, you know, but I guess I'm supposed to introduce myself.
Yeah.
Okay. So I am a practicing artist, visual and media artist, and I write occasionally as well. So, and I've been, I became really active in what used to be called new media back in early 2000s. And since 2009, I've been also working a lot in painting and drawing. So I continue to do writing as well. So that's kind of me.
Great, thanks.
Okay. Where are you based?
Jesse, do you want to go next?
Yeah, for sure. Sorry, I keep having connecting issues, so if I disappear, that's why. I'm Jesse Beyer, and I'm based in Edmonton, Alberta, which is in Canada. And I completed my master's just last August, and it was in curriculum studies. So I focus on areas of pedagogy and learning in relation to some of these philosophical ideas, and especially art. So my master's thesis was very catchy. It was called Schizophrenizing the Art Encounter Towards a Politics of Dehabituation, which I'm not sure will even fit on a book binding, but that's okay. So yeah, I looked at the way in which we learn to encounter art. So what are these kind of habitual practices and interpretive drives that we learn not just in art classes, but throughout kind of different areas of curriculum, and then the axioms those are based on. So I work a lot with Deleuze and Guattari's work, and then some of this newer stuff that we've been working with in these classes. And in addition to that, I teach at the university in education, and I also, I'm an artist. I work mainly in video and sound, so I've just done a couple of things recently in video and sound. And right now I'm working on a book chapter for a philosophy edition about sound and philosophy, and we're looking at some kind of occult sounds, what can kind of space, outer space and kind of spatial things teach us about dismantling, again, these kind of like humanist perspectives of how we think. And yeah, that's a lot of stuff. That's me. Sorry.
Adam, do you want to go next?
Sure. I'm Adam. I also live in Edmonton. Jesse recommended this course to me. I'm an artist. I do different performative things, some writing, some video, some durational performance, different stuff. I don't know. I don't know what else to say about myself.
Who?
David.
I guess David.
David, yeah. Okay.
Diann, Patricia, the rest of the class. Jesse, I suppose you're not Caitlin then?
No, it's not Caitlin. It's Jesse. I think she's just logging with a different account.
Okay, great. So I work in New York. Right now I'm a curatorial assistant at a garden, and that's ending soon, so I'll be freelance unemployed for a couple of months. And my background is in painting and literary studies, sort of a comp lit Chinese and American perspective. My interests. I'm working. My main interest is in planning and in strategy, but theorizing them and how that's possible. Because sort of as I understand it, one of the uglier things about contemporary art is this kind of reflexive anti-institutionalism and the sort of the valorization of spontaneity. So I'm interested in what it means to plan, what it means to be consistent, what it means to commit, what it means to have strategy as opposed to tactics. And some of the ways I'm looking at that are sort of state socialist aesthetics, so propaganda. I'm interested in Hallmark cards, and also in, I have one more project that's coming up about, that's too informed. So yeah, that's me.
Thanks.
Okay, so I guess the last person will be Dylan, right?
Yo.
Hey, yes, I'm Dylan. I just graduated from University of Oklahoma a couple of weeks ago with a BFA and a BA. I grew up in Texas. I'm going to grad school in Santa Cruz in the fall for digital arts and new media. Like 2012, my professor had me start researching like speculative realism stuff for him. So I've kind of been on this rabbit hole since then, in a certain way. This moment right now is actually the sort of culminating of that long process, but I'm really into, like, Cyclonopedia. I'm really into the sort of, like, Mark Fisher, like, CCRU, like, music side of things. I'm also really into Ben Davis, the art critic, and I'm just into art and politics and, like, trying to decide if I actually want to self-identify as an artist or if I just need to, like, do something else. To make any like actual impact on anything. So anyway, yeah, that's me.
Thanks.
Thank you. Patricia, it's back to you.
Thanks, guys.
Go ahead, Diann. I just want to know which one is on so I can switch the camera to that person.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to ask you, my camera is not jumping to people. I sort of have to move it manually. Is that something I've done, or is that something with the connection?
Good.
All right, no matter, whatever.
Unclip your own face. Or you can sort of fix which camera you're looking at by double-clicking it. And if you make sure there's no white box on any of those cameras, then it'll jump around on its own.
How do I get it off the white box on me?
Just click it. Click the white box.
Ah, okay, good. Got it.
I just want to like also say this. As far as the YouTube recording and what other people see is concerned, you can choose which person you want to look at, but I decide what goes onto the YouTube video and the archive, and I usually keep the speaker on so the image corresponds to the voice. So right now you're on. Regardless of which one you've chosen. So you don't have to worry about that. I'm here to...
Okay,
and you guys can just concentrate on the content.
Mm-hmm. Okay, no, it's more just what I was... Anyway, it's fine. It's sorted. Okay, so I thank you for that. Seems like a great group. I will, I think, message over to Suhail now. And he... I'm presuming everyone's done the reading of at least the Ape Says No piece. Hang on here, let me message him.
Do you want me to do the little bio? Do you want me to introduce his bio while you get in touch with him, Dan?
Yeah, why don't you do that?
Okay.
That'd be great.
Okay. So, as we said like earlier, tonight our guests were very lucky to have Suhail Malik with us. Who writes on political economy theory and the axioms of contemporary art. So Malik holds a readership in critical studies at Goldsmiths in London, where he's program co-director of the MFA Fine Art. And I'm a bit confused on the dates. For 2012 to 2015, Diann, Suhail is visiting fellow at the Center
for... That's right.
Okay, so 2012 to 2015, Malik is a visiting fellow at the Center for Curatorial Studies at Bard College, New York. And in terms of the readings, we just quickly updated his bio, so I don't have it on my printout. His recent publications include the very freshly released anthology Realism, Materialism, Art, co-edited with Christoph Cox and Jenny Jasky, and that's been published by Sternberg Press just a couple of weeks ago. And then there's the Ontology of Finance. It's a kind of large book-length essay in the latest version of Collapse 8, published by Urbanomic in late 2014. And the text, The Ruling Elite Have Feelings Too, in The New Reader, that's also 2015. The article, The Value of Everything, in Textus of Kunst, 2014. Tainted Love, Arts, Ethos, and Capitalization, co-written with Andrea Phillips, in Art and Its Commercial Markets, in 2012. And hopefully, I would like to add that the monograph on the necessity of art's exit from contemporary art will also be coming soon, but no pressure. This is going to go on for a while, so for the sake of getting things moving, I'd just like to welcome Suhail here today, and thank you for taking the time to engage with us. So,
okay. The book is supposedly in the fall. That's the plan. We have not shown the Caesar clip yet. Do you want me to start with that?
Yes, please.
Suhail, can you hear us? Yes, okay. I'll start with that. Yeah. I'm going to try to do the screen share. We'll see if this works. I'll try the screen share first.
So while Diann is figuring out the screen share, I want to talk about the classroom. So the classroom, the Google Classroom for this seminar is already set up, and it's open to all the students and the audit students to kind of like access and to post related material, look at their assignments, upload their assignments, and any kind of like extra conversation can be accessed through the Google Classroom. What we normally do is also we copy and paste the sidebar conversation and all the links and stuff in it into the classroom. So you, if anything interesting happens on the sidebar, you guys can access it later via Classroom. If you don't have the code for the classroom or the address for it, I can just post it here too quietly while Suhail is doing the presentation, so then you guys can copy paste it and enjoy it. Diann, are you ready? There it is. Pass on to you.
I'm ready. Yeah. So this we got 2 minutes here. So sit back and enjoy.
What the hell do you think you're doing, huh? Hey, I'm warning you. Come on, guess. Thank you.
Okay. Everyone saw, heard.
It's quite an introduction, Suhail. That's quite an introduction.
It's a little bit from here.
How would you like to proceed? I mean, we have some questions that are sort of bit ready in advance to get the ball rolling, or would you prefer to jump right in with some sort of commentary to set things off?
I think it's part of your course, it's part of your program. So I think if you maybe some questions would be useful to situate this paper in the course that you've set up.
Sure. So we're starting off with your text, Abe Says No. And you talk about a sort of set of self-perceptions endemic to contemporary art through the example of Arthur Chomsky's 7th Berlin Biennale that was, I should add, like quite a polemic biennale in Berlin. And the document published before the event that maps out the opinions from prominent figures in the art scene over here. Using this Pact for Art document, as it was called, as a kind of analytic device to survey the sort of commanding logics that traverse our field and how we self-identify with them to sort of quote-unquote legitimize our activities. And what you infer from these sort of core shared assumptions pervasive in the contemporary art world is that although they sort of dream of having real political effects, these assumptions actually block the possibility of such a reality intervention of contemporary art. So basically through the collected responses in this survey, you identified like 7.5 assumptions that proscribe such reality intervening, from which I'm just going to synthesize sort of like three key points that seem to be more present in your later developments, because it should maybe be prefaced that that text was, I think, written, as you said, 4 years ago or so. So things have been in development since then. So the first one being that contemporary art, this is again the assumptions endemic to the field, that contemporary art is an exceptional difference machine that abhors norms, absolutes, and standardization. So more or less what you now diagnose as contemporary art's celebration of indeterminacy as an unquestionable liberatory vector. The second one being that contemporary art's legitimacy derives from its critical imperative through which to reflect society while foregrounding claims of free speech. And because of this, contemporary art requires support and protection from the people as a right. So this position, I think, can also include the sort of smugness you were also mentioning in that text with the idea that art and artists should just kind of do whatever they want, name what they want. And the third one would be the fact that contemporary art plays a real role in processes of gentrification, so what you in that article have called like wealth cleansing, and say work as a sort of prototype for the division of labor across the spectrum of life. And very often contemporary art world likes to address these things sort of discursively in public, under the rubric of precarity. But they're often very quick to sort of disavow these things as sort of unfortunate byproducts of an essentially good or benevolent system that is a kind of manifestation of utter liberty. So such a disavowal, I'd mentioned earlier, means that contemporary art seems to have a more religious undertones. This is simply sort of believes in what it says without having substantiation. So the question is basically, in Ape Says No, you make the axiomatic link constraining the political efficacy of contemporary art with the constraints inherent to the efficacy of human rights discourses. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit more about this pairing and how their shared emphasis on indeterminacy impede political efficacy.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you. I'll do what I can. That's quite a question. well, thanks for the summary. I think the it's not, okay, the version of human rights that I, or the theory of human rights that I use in the Ape 7 paper, it's a kind of radical left post-structuralist account of human rights by Costas Tzounis, mm-hmm. Who's based in London. And the argument there is essentially, it's kind of a difference between justice and law, and he kind of restates that argument through human rights claims. And the argument is that justice is irreducible to law, because law does involve certain kind of sets of social, it's a kind of codification of social norms, essentially. Right? And so positive law says you can do this, you can't do this, and so on and so forth. But as we all know and assume, law isn't always right and isn't always just. So you need another principle beyond law, which can sort of break law when it needs to in the name of justice. You can see this in the Apes as a clip that you just showed, where the guy, the brutal, the sadistic zookeeper or the animal sanctuary keeper is law, obviously, because he's there to kind of put the apes in their place and so on and so forth, but not just. Okay. So, and as is kind of very common now, 4 years after that paper, law is not justice. It's in America, if not everywhere, it's very demonstrable. So what Tzounis is arguing is that human rights is a way in which you can have a principle which is recognized, sanctioned, and instituted, which is not reducible to law, but acts upon law. Okay. So the human rights regime, typically, there would be a law in a country which restricts freedom of expression, for example, or sexuality or something like this. And then you can make a claim against the positive laws of the country, the codes that are in place, on the basis of human rights claim. Right? But of course, human rights claim, this is an argument from Arendt and others. I mean, I'll sort of do all this just to flesh out the core logic and then come back to the art moment soon. So the core logic would be something like, there is something called human rights, which are somewhat codified, but what human rights speak to is that which escapes or kind of goes beyond all codification, right? And that's something that law recognizes. Law recognizes human rights. It's not totally external to law, but at the same time, it exceeds law. So human rights become a way in which justice can be enacted through law, but not in the terms of law itself, a positive law. It's a kind of negative, it's a negative virtue, in a way, of what law might be. Or the virtue of law applies to human rights, and it's got a kind of negative effect upon positive, the kind of existing codes, in order to improve them and make them more just. So that's the argument in law, very quickly, and for me, it's because of other work I was doing at the time around human rights and art, it sort of seemed to, I guess the question I was asking was what sense does contemporary art make politically? Well, what is its kind of term of operation? What is politics? I'm not convinced by the broad liberal left claims around contemporary art, but I do think that it, in a way, belongs better to the human rights regime. So the argument that I'm making in the Ape Says No paper is that the exceptionality of arts, at the beginning of the paper, Zemiewski talks about the total freedom of the artist in a field designated by institutions. So there are kind of two principles, one of which is what the artist does, and the other one of which is what the institutions are. And the artists act upon institutions through the freedom of the artist, as implied the constraints of institutions. You can immediately see the parallel with the human rights law setup. Right? Human rights is the kind of freedom to act for justice beyond the positive terms of law. But the problem for me is Chomsky and others kind of tie it into the figure of the artist, which I don't think is... sorry, I've got a big sign coming up here about Paul and the Romans. I'm not quite sure what that is. So the argument I'm making in the paper is that we need to move away from thinking about this logic in terms of the artist, which is still a kind of historical, and certainly in the way that Zemiewski presents it, almost kind of romantic slash modernist figure, and think more about the structural conditions of art. Because I don't think it's necessarily the artist who holds on to these... in a way, this right of this art, of the artist, the kind of critical virtue of the artist, doesn't really lie with the artist. It's a systemic condition. It's something that everyone in the art field agrees to, from the curators to the directors of institutions, to the artists themselves, to writers, critics, gallerists, dealers, so on, everyone, and viewers, audiences as well. Everyone agrees to these basic principles. It's not really about the artist. It's more a systemic condition. And then on the basis of other work that I've done, in criticism of Rancière, the claim I make is that the kind of structural condition for this excess or this exorbitance or this extraneousness of art to its institutional structures, existing institutional structures, lies in art's indeterminacy, contemporary art's indeterminacy, right? So contemporary art is distinct to other forms of communication, messages, images, and so on, because the kind of built-in expectation of the art image is that the viewer completes it. So it doesn't work like the spectacle, it doesn't work like the advertising image, it doesn't work like big data visualizations or other forms of images that operate in our societies, because there's a kind of ineradicable indeterminacy or obscurity within the image. And the game of art is that you try and make sense of the artwork. And of course, everyone can make their own sense of the artwork, so it's a nice sort of individual cultivating activity. But it's also, if you take Rancière's line on it, it's a kind of form of democratization, because everyone has an equal voice in front of the artwork. Can make their own sense. They don't have an equal voice in terms of the power that they have in front of the artwork, clearly not. But in terms of the semantics of the work, everyone has equality. Right? And the artwork kind of permits that equality. It's kind of built into the structure and the kind of address of the artwork that it's indeterminate and allows multiple interpretations. So that last argument about the artwork is a kind of structural equivalent, or the common logic between the human rights fields, what Szymanski claims about the artist and so on, I place at the level of the semantics of the artwork, which is its indeterminacy. And so that's the claim about what contemporary art does. But the reason, okay, so that's the kind of broad, that's the introduction. And the second, the reason Caesar comes in as a no saying Abe is that Caesar's no is very definite. There's nothing indeterminate about it. It's a very clear and explicit no against the injustices of the Abe sanctuary that he's in. What was interesting to me about the film and the way that he says no against the way that I think others, including artists in the art field, say no, is that Caesar's no is institutionally produced, right? So if you remember, Szymanski says speaks about the total freedom of the artist in a field designated by institutions. So the freedom of the artist is distinct from the institutions. De Zunis talks about human rights in excess of positive law. Whereas with Caesar, who's an Abe, who's kind of captured by James Franco, well, unfortunately for Caesar, but it's okay, he gets rid of James Franco at the end of the movie, so we're okay. He's kind of brought up in a human family. He's given a bunch of drugs, to sort of like neural stimulant drugs. He's basically brought up in human institutions and used as a test animal for medical developments, genetic medical developments. So he's a totally institutionalized and artificial creature. I mean, he's not totally, totally artificial because he's an ape. But the only way that he gets to say no, as opposed to all the other apes in the ape sanctuary who have been there for longer and will never say no, is because he's been technically produced or technically supervened upon, right? I'm using that as an analogy. I don't think it's an analogy. I think it's exact. That technical intervention is Caesar's institutionalization, right? So why I'm interested in the film is because the claim against injustice, or the claim for justice, is institutionally produced. Right? No other ape says no because they haven't been institutionalized to the extent in which Caesar has. And for me, this presents another logic of thinking about justice claims. That one generates articulations of injustice, which is to say claims for justice, through institutionalization, not despite or against of or supervening upon them. What this means is that institutions stop being constraints upon justice, so positive law is not a constraint on justice, but become the mechanisms by which justice can be articulated for the first time. And I think that's a task that art, contemporary art, cannot do. The question that because the logics are consistent across these three fields. So the question is, if the art field, we want to make justice claims, which are effective, substantial, real justice claims, what do we need to do in the art field? Not necessarily as artists, because I don't think it necessarily lies upon artists, although I don't want to exclude them either. but it's certainly not restricted to artists, because it's a kind of a structural issue in the art field. So on the one hand, what can we do within art, which is a kind of effective full institutionalization in order to generate new justice claims? But secondly, the diagnosis is that contemporary art is structurally incapable of generating substantial justice claims. Substantial, not okay. It can let me qualify that. It can generate justice claims, but it cannot enact them.
To not let the dead end. Okay, you guys want to say something, because I was going to ask something as I prepared a question. So, Suhail, something that comes in mind in this dichotomy you create, but may not relate, so excuse if it doesn't, is also how contemporary art, the way it works its way through national boundaries and establishes itself globally as a sort of like a set of virtues and practices, but also how, I just thought of this during your presentation, that how human rights is often in geopolitics is kind of like instrumentalized in the same way to break through national sovereignties if needed, and kind of like break the existing sort of like set of law, even international law if needed, to sort of like invade, destroy local sovereignty, and sort of like, so there's also that parallel there between the two.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I mean, I think that's what the biennial is, essentially, the biennial format. It's a kind of collapsing of the two, or a kind of equalization between the two fields. I think the distinction, there is a kind of distinction in principle between the two. Human rights, it's kind of, I'm not sure we really want to get into the human rights stuff too much, but the instrumentalization, as you called it, of human rights, as a kind of, I mean, this happened in the 90s through liberal humanitarian intervention. It failed in Rwanda. It sort of happened towards the end in Yugoslavia. But then it became a kind of Blairite and Clinton going to Bush 2 policy that it was important to do liberal interventions. Sierra Leone is kind of the example from Blair. But human rights depends upon, or calls upon, its universalism as the principle by which it can act everywhere. And there's recent work, which I've just become aware of, that in a way the universalism of human rights is not a kind of camouflage or a smokescreen for Western imperialism, which is how it's often portrayed. It was something insisted upon by colonized countries as a way to kind of equalize the field. I'm recently sort of started to look at that. But in any case, human rights kind of makes a claim that all humans are entitled to this, to these sets of rights, right? And there's some positive content to those rights. And it's kind of prescriptive as well. But contemporary art doesn't prescribe anything, and it doesn't have any positive content to it in its indeterminacy. So in a way, the condition for contemporary art's transnationalism or globalization, I think, is very different to the human rights one, because contemporary art, through its indeterminacy, allows anyone to make whatever sense they want to make of the work, right? Which is a kind of default universalism, but it's a universalism without content. It's a universalism of interpretability, or universalism of like active meaning making, if you have the opportunity to see the work. And this is a kind of, I think this is Rancière's interest in contemporary art, that it doesn't prescribe anything, but it also allows a kind of reconstruction of meaning equally for everyone. Somebody just put up the new piece, right? So I think the two can work together very well, because in a way there's a sense in which they apply beyond the sediments and the traditions of ethnicities, nation states, and the rest of it, of communities and cultures, but from very different angles. In a way, contemporary art sort of comes in from below, if you disregard the institutional frameworks. So semantically, it comes from below, and humanist comes from above. I mean, one way to think about this difference is if if anyone is suffering an injustice or a local oppression, whether they would make an appeal to contemporary art to resolve it or to kind of deal with it. It would be a nonsense to do so, because contemporary art wouldn't affect anything substantial and positive. What would you be appealing to? You'd be appealing to the right to freedom of expression, the right to enjoy one's culture, and so on. But those aren't the direct content of contemporary art. That's what it exemplifies, but not exactly how it works. Right? It works through indeterminacy. So if you did make an appeal to contemporary art, what you'd be making an appeal to would be to make sense of your own life, make sense of your own conditions, which is fundamentally important in human rights, but contemporary art is only a mechanism to do that. It doesn't do it itself.
Thank you. I think others have probably more questions or like comments. I don't want to like take over, but yeah, so if people want to ask something, yeah. Or if Suhail wants to pick up some of the...
I'd like to. It's just a question, sort of going back to the Caesar moment. He can only say no because he's an institutionalized ape, yes, and sort of, so using what that means has allowed him to jump in terms of what his species is. But he doesn't look like he's ready to go into negotiations with the institution in that clip. You know, he's... So the idea of taking... I guess what I'm wondering is that moment of watching Caesar, he's going to take the institution down, even though it built him, right? So if we're going to use this as an example or as an analogy, or if you don't want to call it an analogy, it's fine, but if we're sort of thinking of... If we in fact accept that we are institutional creatures and that we can only do what we do because we are institutional creatures, in the reality of it, is it not important to be able to manipulate and negotiate the existing institutions rather than, you know, rally the troops and take them down? Because I don't think actually what we're calling for is the disassembling of institutions. It's actually a way to work with institutions, but somehow shift them, I guess that's what I'm wondering. Like, it's sort of institutions got him to that point, but then once you're at that point of saying no, disassembling the thing that made you might not be the most productive way to forward, while at the same time you're faced with, you know, this sadistic fucker that you've got to deal with. You know, like, how do you deal with a sadistic fucker when you're wanting to just say no? I guess that's my question.
it's actually quite a demanding question. There are lots of angles. I mean, the only thing I want to stress in the movie is, because it's a pretty crummy movie otherwise. I'm a fan of the movie because it's crummy and cheesy, but but this is the one moment I think kind of stands out from the cheese. It's like the mushroom on the pizza, one mushroom on the pizza. The only thing I want to stress in the movie is the distinction between this form of no saying and the kind of statements that art makes, contemporary art makes. That's it. But let's go with Planet of the Apes for a bit. I haven't seen the sequel to this one. I don't know if anybody here has. I guess some of my people have seen it. I don't know what happens in the next one. But what's clearly going to happen, because we know about Planet of the Apes from the 60s and 70s, is that the apes will take over the world, and humans are going to be slaves of the apes, right? So they build institutions. This is the beginning of institution building in another format than the ones that have taken place so far, which are human institutions. So the no is the kind of beginning of a whole new bunch of institutions and a whole new format and a whole new constituency of who gets to build institutions and in its initial no. So he takes down the human institutions, but it's not simply destructive anarchism. It's a no to negate unjust institutions and build institutions that are more just for the apes, as it turns out, and therefore, the message is kind of distracting. It's fine, you can't do them, I'll just ignore them. The existing institutions, they're not totally taken down. He kind of flees into the woods in order to kind of build the kind of rebel forces and then sort of right back in the urban spaces and so on and so forth. The main thing is he gets rid of James Franco, who's the kind of parent, right? So that's one part of it. And the paper was written in 2011, and I think what I was trying to... One of the things that was around in the paper was Occupy at the time, which is a way of saying no to finance and kind of capitalism up to that point, after the crash. So Occupy you could read as a no-saying ape, right, in these terms. But it didn't say anything else. The only institution it wants to build was Occupy itself. And in a way, the paper preceded the emergence of accelerationism as a distinct, identifiable thing. But I think it's a proto-accelerationist paper. And I wish I'd said the word accelerationism, but I'm too averse to make plan to be able to kind of move towards it at that time. So I think the question you're asking is, well, what do you do once the no has been made? And of course, my own inclination, my own sort of wishes are left accelerationist. I'm very clear about that. And left accelerationism is exactly about reworking with institutions. But I think it's too politically abstract just to think about what one does with institutions. I think the issue is kind of, What does any particular institution do, and does any particular institution allow you to build and effect the justice that one's seeking? Right. So the question for Caesar is, he says no to his oppression, which is a first move that must be made. Let's kind of imagine a counter scenario. So this guy is like beating Caesar. And Caesar's saying, hey, can we talk about this? How do we begin to negotiate this? Like, you don't need to do this. I'll kind of go back in the cage. If you kind of give me a few more peanuts, it'll be fine. It's not going to work, right? But it's not going to work in terms of the logic of the movie, because the important thing about the movie is the fact that he speaks. And so it's no longer the humans that speak, but apes, animals speak as well. And that's the kind of dramatic moment of the film. The only kind of worthwhile moment of the film, really. But it's important that, in a way, the demand for, because it's a film against oppressions, which works very differently to the way the films in the 60s and 70s worked, because it's a demand against oppression, it has to be no. You can't, the fundamental statement behind any consequent negotiation would be, no, this oppression cannot continue. No, this injustice does not continue. We can talk about how to do that, but it's pretty clear in the conditions in which they find themselves as apes, they're not going to get a fair deal from any institution, right? Maybe apart from the people at the top of the tower in Independence Day welcoming the aliens, but apart from them, the institutions won't allow negotiations, so they have to go into the woods and the rest of it. So anyway, this is all kind of getting a bit too climate gauge specific. The point I was making was simply that I think it's too much to ask for a general logic of what specifically one should do with institutions. Because if you simply kind of say, okay, everything has to begin with negotiation of institutions. Not all institutions allow you to negotiate on your own terms. What's important in the film is that Caesar gets to articulate, not as an animal, but through linguistic semantics, gets to articulate the condition of all future negotiations, which will include war with humans later on. And that's what's institutionally produced. So I think for me the kind of lesson I'm wanting to draw from the film for the art field, but more generally, which I think is a kind of I'd say is probably liberationism. I've wanted that is that this very basic claim that the claim for injustice doesn't come despite institutions, but can come from within them in a way which is much more effective. Right, because again, to go back to the film as a metaphor or a parable, the other apes are also essentially saying no or enacting no, because they don't want to be beaten. They're hurt and they're injured, and they're kind of a bunch of victims, but they can't do anything about their victimhood, right? Because they haven't been as fully institutionalized, or as thoroughly and totally institutionalized. They haven't been as accelerated as Caesar has.
I like how in your...
I don't have a direct answer.
Yeah, no.
I was just going to say to Diann, I don't have a direct kind of institutions or no institutions. It's more just, I think, this field of invention across institutions. But the point I'm making is that you can't do without them. For claims of political injustice, those justice claims are made through institutions and happen by institutions. How that happens per institution depends on the claim and what the institution's capacities are.
Go ahead, Ben.
I was just going to hand over to you, Patricia. That's all. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just kind of wondering because just a couple of quick parallels came up because I think also in like 2011, sort of like maybe the last wave of the Valencia super hype in the contemporary art world, and it just brought to mind as well like one of the main.
Patricia, it was the last.
Sort of in 2011.
It was the last wave of what?
Of this Vincent super hype, you know, like it was already kind of coming to an end.
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah. So a lot of us were sort of working with a lot of these ideas at the time. And one thing that was always troubling me about, you know, some older texts, say the mid-90s, the disagreement, so not even before politics of aesthetics and so on, in disagreement, where, you know, basically the enactment of democracy or the enactment of politics for him is always premised on the recognizability of the speech, right? So what he always talks about was the kind of plebeians, the noise or the brouhaha of the plebeians was finally recognized by the patricians as speech. And to me this always seemed like, how does one, I understand what you're saying about recognizing and mobilizing the capacities kind of engendered upon you through the institutionalization, but I also wonder, like, why do I have to speak the master's language? If you know what I'm saying. Because it seems to me that Caesar's no, had he enacted it in Chinese, for example, which is equally a linguistic utterance of a, you know, linguistic entity, it still wouldn't have been recognized by those guys. And so my question is, like, do you see what I'm saying about the difficulty? Because I understand it in this sort of way that you have to mobilize your complicity within a situation and the sets of capacities that institutionalization has afforded you, and then deploy it in that moment, what do you call it, negative affirmation. And I'm just curious about how that, you know, it's even, not to put it in too Hegelian, but this like master-slave dynamic. Like, why do I have to speak the master's language in order for my claim to injustice to be understood as such?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's a core question. One doesn't have to. No, I think it's yeah. The problem here is, okay, around Rancière specifically and technically, Rancière assumes that everyone has speech, every human has speech, or the capacity to understand. Okay? So the kind of the schematic version is the slave and the Greek patrician. There's no equality whatsoever. There's no presumed equality between them. But insofar as the patrician tells the slave what to do and the slave understands it, there's an equality of through speech or through understanding, through intelligence, right? And for us, that's the basis for any other claims that may be made by the slave. So Rancière's version isn't necessarily about speaking, it's about intelligibility or intelligencing, I guess, right? That in a way, one can understand the speech of others. Not necessarily that one has to speak like others do, and it's only the case that I guess the claim I'm making is that the no has to be, you're quite right, in Chinese it wouldn't work, as it's the Chinese dubbed version of it, in which case it works perfectly well. So the institutionalization in a way already condemns, I guess, the argument with the institutionalization already condemns you to the form of oppression or the language of oppression, which is exactly what one is seeking to remove oneself from. And here you get it. I mean, the exact parallel is post-colonial arguments in the language of the oppressed, right? In pedagogy, we go to Paulo Freire, Augusto Bauer, and people like this, who are trying to get sort of the oppressed classes to speak in their own languages or in their own terms rather than the terms of the educated and so on. I think that's a legitimate point. The problem for me in making that claim is how you maintain the integrity of the language or the code of communication or the way of belonging of the oppressed populations, those who are seeking justice, without resorting to the autonomy claims. The autonomy claims. Which are behind people like Zhemyevsky's Total Freedom of the Artist intervening on institutions, right? The question is, I guess, something like, well, if people are speaking their own language, they're already institutionalized in that language, right? If you're making a claim that let's call it the language of the oppressed, right? Which I think language is a form of institution, of course, it's kind of not structured. Built structures and the rest of it, but it's a form of institution. So it's not as though any language that isn't already the language of the master is not institutionalized. It's a different type of institution. If you think about it in that way, it becomes more about the politics between two institutional forces. Right? The question is, how do you get the oppressing institution to recognize the oppressed institution in terms other than their oppression? And it seems to me either you can't do it simply by carrying on. You can't do it simply by carrying on speaking your own language, which is what slaves do. What in Planet of the apes are doing anyway because they're communicating. And I think there's a scene slightly before the scene that that was shown where Caesar says no, where he's kind of communicating with an orangutan through signs, and then there's kind of subtitles in English for us, which is like. Very nice. They're communicating anyway, right? And then they communicate after Caesar kind of liberates them from the sanctuary, which is not a sanctuary. So this communication is going on, but they're not recognized as having legitimacy. And I think the differences between the ontological equality, I guess, between different languages, which one can presume, and once you presume it, and political equality, which precisely you cannot presume because that's the problem, right? And so in order to kind of deal with political inequality, it seems to me that you, I guess what I'm trying not to say, but I have to say, is that in a way you need to confront the oppressor in a language that the oppressor understands is a problem for them. Right? Because if you carry on speaking your own languages, there's no inherent reason why the oppressor would understand it to be a problem. Because it's the very condition of the oppression that the languages are different. So either you speak the oppressor's language in a way that is not what they want to hear in their own language, which I guess might be a sensible critique, or you speak a third language, which neither oppressed nor oppressor speak, and changes the institutional field, which again would sort of be, I think, a kind of contemporary art claim. I guess I'm more interested in the first of those options because it's a direct confrontation with the oppressor in their own terms, but in terms of their comprehension, or what they're prepared to comprehend. And I also don't think it's the case that speaking or articulating oneself in the language of others is necessarily condoning their mastery. You could call it translation.
So I have an example.
Or hybridization.
I have a different example.
I'd just like to second that before we move.
Go ahead.
If I could just sort of second the point on that. Wait, before we move on, I mean, I'm thinking, you know, having a language is a power, and if you have a group that is disempowered to gain that additional power of being able to speak the language of the master is not, it's sort of, the understanding is like, oh, why do we have to speak the master's language? Is more like, oh, we're being put upon to speak this language. It's more like you actually gain power. It's one way that not having power can be overcome, actually, is having the language of the master is sort of taking power in and of itself, where it's the first step to doing
it.
I guess
one way to articulate that would be, one way to articulate that would be that one increases one's capacities.
Yeah.
Right.
One thing I want to.
Let me just finish this one point. I think if it's a question of which is the way would conveniently be or conventionally be taken, I think in critical and I think victimized discourses. If it's a question of one replaces one's language with the language of the master, then that's continued oppression, of course. But if one speaks the other language as well, right, then in a way one has more capacity than the master who doesn't speak. The humans can't speak ape. The apes can now speak ape or do ape as well as speak English or Chinese later on because they're going to take over the world. So I think something about increasing capacities through institutionalization would be the way to reformulate it outside of the logic of continued subordination or assimilation. Yes.
One thing I wanted to say.
That's fine. You go ahead. Go ahead. Sorry.
Please.
Okay, I was going to say,
David, you got the floor.
The other...
What I wanted to say was that the other thing about this discussion of master's languages and servant's languages is that it relies on a kind of simplistic idea of ownership that's not really adequate to the increase of capacities. So, for example, to say that because my mother is Chinese and because I grew up speaking Chinese, that Chinese is mine is kind of a problematic assertion. And it relies on a... And there's Walter Ben Michaels, who's kind of an asshole overall, but is an interesting figure because he comes from a post-structuralist background but ended up being... But he makes the really important point that language becomes the one of the key parts of identity politics, because it is compatible with anti-foundationalism, because it's not biological, but yet in practice, it's mostly, you know, genetic, right? That you inherit it because of the context in which you grow up. And so it kind of becomes a useful code word for this. It does exactly the same things that biological sensitivities do. So he problematizes this whole idea of inheritance. He says that cultural inheritance uses the discussion of protecting cultural inheritance and multicultural politics uses the exact same ideas of ownership, albeit with different kinds of capital, that tax cuts for the rich have to do with, right? He basically says that the discussion of I should be able to speak the language that my parents speak is very related rhetorically to the campaign against the estate tax. So I just wanted to say that I think the main problem in the claim, like, why should I speak the oppressor's language is like that possessive, the oppressor's part, like that. These institutional forms or these forms can move with a degree of mobility between contexts. And so, for example, in the Chinese context, like, there was this whole discussion about whether or not Marxism was appropriate being a Western construction. And then basically people made the point that I made, which is that these things are not entirely tethered to their places of origin. And that tethering to the place of origin is often related to a certain kind of a capitalist logic of how exactly ownership works in the cultural domain.
Yeah, I agree with this kind of capacities thing. Yeah, I just think it's important to qualify it because the example that comes to my mind immediately, you know, being Canadian, is like residential schools and of the indigenous population, and so. This is not an example where I would say it's about bequeathing a set of capacities. It's literally abolishing somebody's culture. So I think that this idea of the, you know, that relation needs to be very precisely about an amplifying one rather than a totally destructive one, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, I would say that in that case, that the problem is not that you're abolishing people's culture, but you're abolishing their power. And what matters there isn't the language that's being spoken, but who's the principal of the school.
Patricia, let me give... Patricia, my example might be also like kind of like useful here, and it's a political example, and it has to do with the Iranian Revolution, right? So while the Iranian government, the revolutionary Iranian government, silenced and murdered leftists and communists, it only imprisoned in harsh condition the reformers. So gave them no good pillows or like no blanket. But they survived, and actually by surviving, by sort of treating them different than communists, they developed their own opposition that later on, within 20 years, they kind of left the jail, enter the parliament, and now they're even sort of like our ministers or like, but the communists were like secretly murdered and destroyed, right? So this is sort of like highlighting what Patricia was saying in terms of sort of like how there's a little bit of gray area in which the powerful also decide who to institutionalize and who to sort of like accelerate and who to kind of like eliminate completely. And as it stands now, Iran, which before the revolution had one of the strongest leftist communist socialist movements in the entire Middle East and almost third world, sort of like is without a left-wing movement, whereas our sort of like new liberals, quasi-liberal formation that came out of Ayatollah Khomeini's sort of like even opposition to it are kind of like in power.
The just go back to the art a little bit. I mean, I want to take up Patricia's point before I do. I completely agree that the problem the argument Patricia presents, which is an important one, about minorities being coordinated to basically colonial processes. But it's not just the colonialism. It takes all kinds of appropriation, I guess, or expropriation, follow this model. I guess the issue is how to articulate one's claims, which are not reducible to that of the colonizing or more powerful actor. How to articulate those in a way which the actor understand the colonizing actor or the powerful actor understands to be an injustice, right? If it's not understood to be an injustice, then it carries on because it doesn't see any injustices. And here, I think I have to presume that the oppressive mechanisms have, and I think this is right, have their own sort of moral. Somebody's phone is kind of. Have their own moral sort of presumptions. There's kind of too many things to talk about. Okay. I think what I'd say to Patricia is that while understanding and fully accepting the difficulty that she's articulated where First Nations are basically eradicated as a culture, or even as a power base, I think both, and one through the other. The question still remains, how do First Nations get to articulate their interests in ways that are recognized and legitimate and taken seriously by those who are basically disregarding them? And it's going to be an increasingly important problem as Canada freezes in the north and the resources become available for extraction. As I understand it, the First Nations have kind of been pushed up into the north as a way for the European powers to settle in the south of Canada. But now, of course, they want the north because that's where the riches are. So there's going to be some negotiation. I mean, of course, at this point, it's also fully accepted that the First Nations people speak English or French because they're part of the state processes. To come back to the art field, I think what's the kind of parallel move, and I think this is to do with the structures of politics in these cases, and in a way the underlying convention behind both the art field and the kind of post-colonial claims is of course a kind of post-structuralist sense of disidentification with power, disidentification with structures, and disidentification with authorities, all of which I think are untenable in terms of future political programs and rectifying injustices, which is where I think I'm an accelerationist. So I think in the art field, what we need to understand is how to do things in art which accept its institutionalization as a positive condition, rather than as what Jemieski calls externality, like a designated area in which artists have to unfortunately work, which I think is the prevalent sense in the art field. So you get invited to buy annual, it's a great opportunity for this and that and the other, especially marketization, but nonetheless the biennial kind of necessarily sucks because it's an institutional format which is going to restrict things I might want to do as well as giving the opportunity. So for me, there's a kind of general skepticism about institutionalization in the art field from artists, from active practitioners, curators, writers, and so on and so forth, which in a way gets in the way of really doing a lot with art if it took its institutionalization more seriously, partly because those people that do take its institutionalization seriously, well, they're the people that's currently running the art world and why it stinks, right? But also what they do, what I think the current hegemon does, is try and keep art itself, to try and protect art itself from being overly contaminated by institutionalization, which includes the market. So there's a kind of constant discourse in which art's institutionalization as a fact is split from art's institutionalization in principle, which shouldn't happen. And so what you see there is a way in which art's own language is protected from the dominant languages of power in the art field, which are now the dominant languages of power per se globally. But that's exactly a way in which art, if it kind of overreaches and starts saying, hey, look, we need to start speaking institutional languages, you're not doing what art should really be doing, right? Which is just like its own semantic indeterminacy claim. You're making kind of effective claims on its conditions of production or its conditions of circulation, or you're making didactic demands which is sort of like not very welcome, unless they're done in a specific way, Hirshhorn or somebody like this, which are kind of just cheesy, right? So there's a sense in which I think what's needed is like an increased capacity, is an incapacitation of art, and increasing its capacities to deal with its institutionalized structures as part of its semantics, like ingrained into what the artwork is doing, rather than as an externality that it unfortunately has to encounter or deal with. And I actually think that maybe because I've been teaching in curating courses recently, I think curators are the kind of lead actors in this. But most curators in curating education tries to remove the semantics of the work from its institutional structures, and the curator acts as a kind of buffer zone between the two. Whereas I think the curator is at this point the channel between the semantics of the work and the and institutional forces. It's of course available for artists and others to do, but they're not institutionally placed in that position. In fact, they're required to not place themselves explicitly anyway in that position.
This kind of just like calls to mind something, like just to keep it, I think it's good that you brought it back to the art track, you know, because we've got to kind of keep some focus here. Again, this is not really related to the reading, but I think it's useful in the sense of this embeddedness that you seem to be addressing. And I think I don't recall the exact three examples, but there was you did a talk recently with Nick Chernicek at Mercer Union in Toronto, where you were identifying like these sort of like, was it like two or three affordances of what you could call the axiomatics or the kind of institutional quality of contemporary art that could be leveraged. So I think like one was that there's like money. It's a field that, although we maybe don't have it ourselves, there is cash flow in the art world that could be mobilized. I mean, I wonder if you could just speak about these points that you think are sort of present.
My notes just here.
Mm-hmm. Great.
No, the three. I mean, these are three that I've just pulled out of nothing really. But it seemed to me, and I take that back. It's partly through previous discussions with Diann and others as well, of course. I think there are three things that contemporary art, because that's where we hegemonically are, in a way, it's the institutional structure in which we're placed, or which we find ourselves, but also the kind of condition for kind of an incapacitation, right, of art as well. So the three things that it currently has, which I think could be mobilized, one is a kind of transdisciplinarity, which I think is increasingly important as the universities go into business models and become the disciplines fly to safety. Contemporary art is one of the few places that you can have this kind of discussion, where we kind of zone between First Nations into art, into kind of colonial systems and rancière. And so, I mean, you could probably do it in theory as well, but it seems to me that the kind of main host for a kind of open discussion or kind of like a transversality of concerns probably doesn't happen in theory as much as it happens in art now. But also art kind of has a far greater reach as well, both in disciplines, geographically, power-wise, and so on. The second thing is that art is now allied with power, despite the content claims against it, mostly speaking. So the Venice Biennial this year is a good example of a total denial that the Venice Biennial is what's happening at the Venice Biennial and Verso's Biennial this year? Lots of demonstrations of examples and manifestations of populations and people who are subject to global oppressive forces, and art exposes that. And the Venice Biennial is just the very thing that's kind of good. You arrive by yacht to kind of look at the immiseration that your yacht ownership is causing. But there's a kind of disarticulation between the two. It's a kind of crude way of putting it, but there's clearly something going on there. And contemporary art text is a very good kind of prophylactic against, you know, you can recognize that there's misery in the world through the artwork because you're not actually confronting it directly. And also because it's an artwork, it becomes part of symbolic currency and the rest of it. Anyway, so the point I would make would be to switch that around and to say, no, we recognize that art is part of power. People in big yachts do turn out to biennials. They're interested. There's a lot of, not in absolute terms, in terms of global wealth, it's not a huge amount of money in art, but in cultural terms, there seems to be increasing volumes. And also, the cultural elites enjoy it. Right? It's a way for them to recognize themselves. So it seems to me it's closer to nexus of important power than, say, film or music or literature, for example, as cultural forms. And then the third thing I think art has, which is like the thing it declares openly for itself, is that its primary concern is mediation, mediatics, communication, right? So it's actually very expert in understanding and dealing with how images are mediated and how they transmit. Like, what are the terms for successful transmission and unsuccessful transmission? You know, and also generic genre specificity of images. The last example, the last mentioned axis, I guess, the best example of this is post-internet art, which unfortunately has become something about how to become a better capitalist. Right? So if you look at the rhetorics and discourses around post-internet art, it started off as a kind of counter circuit or a mode of circulation which didn't belong to the galleries, didn't belong to the hegemonic forms of art production. So it seemed kind of emancipatory in terms of allowing people to do contemporary art stuff, I think, essentially, because there was nothing about the type of art that it was generating that got outside of the generic problem of art, but the mechanisms of circulation were distinct to the kind of closed forms of the gallery circuit and the sort of capital investments in that. But as it gets attention over the last 2 to 3 years, those claims have been not abandoned, but reflected towards, yeah, we have to have very good circulation to get attention because it's an attention economy. And the reason to get attention in the attention economy is to do well in the art world. So it's a bit like the hackers become the security experts. It's that kind of model. Right? But I think beyond the kind of unfortunate example of post-internet art, what it demonstrated is that people in the art world can work very quickly and very adeptly at mobilizing systems of communication and mediation. So I think those three things together are actually quite powerful. A lot could be done with that, because those are kind of three important, I mean, certainly the power thing is important, I mean, definitionally important, mediation, communication, fundamental to symbolic economies such as those in the global north. And transdisciplinarity seems to me the one thing that could really be actively generated to produce produce non-standard forms of communication. I mean, I see the New Center is doing that, for example.
I just want to jump in here. I realize it's already past 1 o'clock. We only pulled you in for an hour, but if you would be willing, I want to see if anyone other than Patricia, I have questions for you before you go. Do you have time, a few extra 10, 15 minutes for that? Or
yeah, let's
do you
have 20 minutes. Yeah. No.
Okay, did anyone else ask anything?
Samuel, yeah. Do you want to bring
Dylan, do you want to ask? Go ahead.
Yeah, I had to find the unmute button. Okay, I guess, which of these two things should I say? Okay, basically...
Are you still in bed?
Oh, yeah, no, and I moved into bed in the past, like, 30 minutes. It's far more comfortable. Oh, my goodness, it's kind of romantic, actually. Okay, basically, we're talking about, like, how do we speak to an institution in a way that not only does it understand, but it understands it as a problem for them. You know, there is an injustice that the institution can recognize. And I guess I got a little bit confused in the conversation as to when we were talking about human rights, when we were talking about art, the things cross over so much. But in any case, I guess I'm wondering, like, if there's a distinction to be made between how we should be interacting with art institutions in particular versus other sorts of institutions, like, out in the rest of the world, basically. Because for me, like, it seems like eventually we'd like to move beyond just art institutions. Or maybe, like, the art institutions would become allies and then move towards other institutions or something. But I guess I'm just wondering how you sort of see this distinction playing out, or if you had any thoughts about this, or if that makes any sense.
Yeah, let me just kind of backtrack one second. I'll take up. Sorry?
No, Diann, what go did ahead. You say? Go ahead. Find nothing. I have okay. some thoughts, but if you're ready, go ahead.
Okay, I'll be very brief, and then you can chip in. The issue became how to speak to institutions in a language that they'll understand, or in a, you know, so they understand that they have a problem. That's a kind of consequence of what I was articulating. The point that I really want to make is that we speak because we're institutionalized anyway. So, and I don't want to turn into simply a matter of choices because I'm a good structuralist, so I understand that institutions make us speak, and also that we don't necessarily choose which institutions we enter into. So Daniel, I think it is, Daniel's early example of Chinese, like, you know, or David, sorry. David's an example of Chinese, like, you grow up in the languages that you speak and you don't choose them necessarily. I mean, you can choose other ones later on. But the issue for me is that institutions are the conditions for our articulations. So the issue then is, insofar as one has a sense of injustice or indignation about one's conditions, what actions need to be taken, and what speeches need to be, what speechifying needs to happen. And I think, in a way, that sort of is the response to your second question. I don't think there's anything really to be chosen between anything that significant about going through art institutions first, and then secondly through other types of institutions. Right? It depends on what the political claim is. It depends on what the indignation is about. So if indignation is about the market mechanisms of art, for example, which it is, or like power concentrations through museums, and the way that the notion of a public culture is being eroded because the public museums are now in the pockets of the elites and the galleries, right? That's a form of indignation that would lead to action upon art institutions. But if your indignation, or if the political cause, is, because Patricia brought it up earlier, is kind of First Nations issue, which was a exhibition that was on in Toronto when I did the talk with Cernicek then, then it seems to me that it's perfectly possible, because of art's transdisciplinarity, kind of its lack of definition in terms of what it's about, because it's no longer simply about art, I think, alone, you know, like a formalist practice, it would be perfectly possible to intervene upon other institutions which are outside of the art system. I would even say that the second, the intervention outside of the art system, is the more common thing as regards political and socially directed practices. What they tend not to do, broadly speaking, in terms of the politics they put forward, is deal with art institutions. Right? And for commercial practices, or what will get called commercial practices, what they deal with are art institutions, but not deal with sort of institutions. Right? So, I mean, in terms of, like, the pragmatics of the work. So I don't have a hierarchy between art institutions and other kinds of institutions. I think it depends on what the practice is, and also what the claims are, and what the politics, the demanded politics. I mean, the way to, I guess, rearticulate that is what's the indignation or injustice. And indignation is a term borrowed from Boltansky and Chiappella's New Spirit of Capitalism. For them, it's the kind of motor, the engine of critique. And I think it's right. It's a little bit subjectivist, but So, if your indignation is about how crappy the art system is, because mostly it is, I think, then that produces certain types of interventions and requires certain type of articulations, right? But what we also need to understand is that the articulation that you would make in the art field is because of the art institutions. It's not against them. Right? It's not despite them. It happens through them. And I think that's the attack, my attack on autonomy as a solution for arts politics. Right? And for me, I was going to make earlier when David was speaking, for me it's an issue about, well, what are we doing in art education? Right? So what are we doing right here, right now? In this, what I do as a professional art teacher and so on, if you look at discourses on art education, the standard thing is you can't teach art. Like, art is something that happens, you can guide people, blah, blah, blah. You can't teach art. And then you just think, well, just design. You can't teach art. It's not doing anything in the institution. Just get out and make space for people who can do things and want to do things, who actually want to teach art. And I think it's important to understand that art gets taught. This is not. The reason people say that, that formulation, you can educate, but you can't. If you look at, I did another paper, which is on Rhetoric Journal, called Education Sentimental and Non-Sentimental, which is about this dichotomy. Saying you can't teach art, but people can be educated, is just a kind of get-out clause of saying, I'm not going to tell people what to do because artists have their own speech, their own voices, blah, 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 blah. But I'll take the money for being in the room at the same time and in fact telling them very exactly what to do, which is what often happens. So for me, the issue about education is actually, I think it's imperative about institutionalization in order to have artists articulate demands, right? Social demands, demands organized around justice, emancipation, all kinds of demands. And I think that can be learned through institutionalization, not despite it. So for me, it's a kind of it's a vindication of art education. Right. I mean, that's the kind of personal thing about just sort of understanding one's own work in good faith rather than bad faith. But I think beyond that, it's a very fundamental problem in the art field, because through what we assume is autonomy as a kind of condition for political claims. Right. An autonomy necessarily means a non-institutional basis, because one is autonomous from all institutionalizations as an artist. This is what happens in the pact for art. This is what Shemesky proposes, but it's the commonplace. And it seems to me that actually debilitates. It allows the making of independent claims, but it debilitates being able to enact upon them other than the circumscribed fields in which autonomy is created, which is precisely as a kind of protected institution form. And that's the logic we need to get out of. Mm. So that was 12 minutes on one question. I'll try and be so if there are any others.
Does anyone else want to ask anything?
If no one has one, I have a real dirty one to just ruin your morning, Suhail, but I would be more than happy to hear anyone else chime in if you have something pressing. Please do so, and if not, then I can go ahead.
I have just, I guess, an example of maybe a more concrete example of what Suhail was just talking about in relation to art education. Because I think there's been a movement in the last little while, especially in North America, that art has become sexy again. I don't know if again is the right way to think about it, but it's approached in education in very different ways, where it is sold literally as this thing that everyone can do and everyone can be creative, and ties into this larger rise of the so-called creative class. And then art becomes, at least in the research I've been doing, kind of related more to questions of communication and communication in terms of those dominant narratives. So we teach students how to interact with art so that they can produce and consume in the visually saturated world and compete in this kind of global marketplace. And so maybe this is an example of how this institutionalization teaches us maybe the dominant kind of rhetorics or the things that these larger institutions impose, but the question becomes how do we expose kind of that excess that art art also produces these things that are outside of those dominant, and I think that's maybe what we're trying to get at, is how do we take the reins of some of these institutions and then repurpose them towards more productive ends, or however we want to term production, I guess. But it's something that I've seen specifically, and something that I'm thinking about in relation to this class, is if this question of like what is the function, while the functionality is always going to be indeterminate, that it's very easily co-opted into these kind of larger institutions. And then art becomes just another means to an end that's always already known, as opposed to its more kind of indeterminate capacities, or the capacity to create new potentials for thinking. So in my own work, that's something I'm very cautious of, is that art is being kind of used in a certain way to kind of propagate ways of thinking, ways of being, especially in education, that are limiting in terms of what it could do, which is create more potentials. So anyways, that's not really a question. That's just a thought.
No, I think, I mean, I'm partial agreement, partial disagreement with you. I think the key thing I'd sort of pick up is the point you made in passing about, in a way, a kind of commitment to indeterminacy does nothing to prevent those kinds of expropriations, right? In a way, if we see it everywhere, right? The art becomes part of the creative classes. It becomes a kind of selling point for institutions to get students. It becomes part of being sexy. It becomes a way to train yourself to be a cultural entrepreneur. If that's understood to be a problem because of the links to capitalization, gentrification, the reorganization of cities away from working classes and the rest of it, which it is, what's to be done about it? And it seems to me that there's two options. One is to retreat from institutionalization, which would be a standard sort of model. The other would be to kind of retreat, not from institutionalization, but to kind of insist even more upon a non-instrumentality of art, right? So in a way, you go back into more sort of a Dornian model of autonomy and so on. And the way that gets articulated is precisely that you produce kind of non-functioning or quasi-functional images or artworks and so on. Two problems with that. Firstly, insofar as it's indeterminate, it's not saying no to anything. It perfectly allows the kind of co-option that you were speaking about. And the second thing is that that's precisely the art image now. That's what works so well in terms of the logic of capitalization you just mentioned, right? So it seems to me that if the dynamic that you're discussing of art's increasing cultural prominence and success as a vector for capitalization is now in train. And this is around in art schools a lot, I think, at the minute, generally speaking. And I don't see alternative art schools which emphasize just practice to be any responses whatsoever. I think that they make the problem worse. This might come back to an issue about speaking the language of the oppressor or so on. There's nothing in the indeterminacy which is not the language of the instrumental image, right? Not the language of instrumental discourse. There's nothing in that which prevents instrumentalization. That's clearly what's happened to the art world in the last 20, 30 years, right? It's allowed itself, it's become heavily instrumentalized because the kind of way that it works doesn't permit any traction one way or the other, right? The organization and the vector of the artwork along sort of directions of heavy capitalization, which is, again, microscopic in terms of the generality of people working in art. It's kind of very concentrated capital power. It's totally permitted, and there's absolutely no problem with it from the side of art. It can't do anything about that capitalization. I don't think creating alternative institutions, I'm not sure about that in terms of the thing that just came up. So for me, the no saying ape becomes an even more important model, because the way that you could obstruct this kind of capitalization from the side of art, like art making, art circulation, is through content, right? Content, in a way, the indeterminacy of content, which is what I mean by indeterminacy, means that there's, as I said, no obstruction or no traction one way or the other from to any form of adaptation of the artwork, right? So you could have most kind of condemning work on gentrification that you could think of, and it could easily be gentrified in contemporary art, or easily be accommodated within the gallery circuits and gentrification within contemporary art model because of the indeterminacy of the work, which is you make your meaning of it, I make my meaning of it, and furthermore, the institutional price mechanisms aren't really what art is about because they're kept separate from one another. My sense is that the way to deal with this as an issue is to fold them into one another very forcibly. But that means making specific claims on pricing and on content itself. And the no is a way of saying, you know, of kind of having a determinate content in the work. I mean, again, just to go back to the movie, if Caesar's being beaten by, let's call him Brad, because he looks like a Brad. Right, so Caesar's being beaten by this guy. So Caesar gets up and goes, meh, meh. Yeah. If Abe says meh, that seems to be more the contemporary art condition. It's not enough to kind of, you could enter into negotiations, but the negotiations would be equally valid on the part of, on the side of the, you know, on the side of the guy doing the beating or the institutions as it would on the side of the ape. And that's not enough, but it seems to me that more determinate content produces clear criteria and a kind of clear term back to the major title of this series of talks. It kind of produces a commitment with a series of ramifications, right? Or this kind of neo-rationalist notion of reason, which have to be followed through. And then it's on the line. I don't know, this might come back to the point that Patricia wanted to make. Oh, sorry, do you have a problem?
I think that's a really nice, that ape says meh is kind of a nice analogy to think of the limits of the this post-structural idea that everyone has an opinion and everyone has a perspective and therefore every perspective is equal and valuable, and to try and reinstate that sense of commitment, I think is key, is a really interesting key there, maybe.
Yeah, technically the everyone has an opinion thing isn't post-structuralism, it's liberalism. But the kind of it's an allowance within post-structuralism.
Yeah, this breakdown, I guess, or this like explosion of meaning is maybe what I'm referring to more.
Do you have time for the Killer Patricia question? I'm curious about it, but I also sound that it's already
let me hear what the question is.
It's not killer, but
it's just too hard.
You wrote it, so it's but I do have to apologize to the rest of the group because I had just finished, and I can really recommend, because as many of you know, Suhail is writing about like finance theory and political economy, so got like basically a book length essay. It's like, I don't know, 3,000-page essay or something in this.
That's not the whole essay.
Okay, but it's like a good chunk. It's like 150 pages or something. Anyways, it's called The Ontology of Finance, and so it wasn't on the list, and I don't have a PDF. But there was one. It's one where there's just like ginormous footnotes in there. So this is getting to be a really picky point, but I think it has a strong relation because, you know, the title of the class is Art and Its Reason, so we have to kind of try to understand. What do we mean by reason? What do we mean by rationality? Both in terms of like how we seek to legitimize art, what we want from it, and then also how art participates in, you know, programs of rationality. And it seems to me that in this sort of, at least as a kind of semi-lay person in this neo-rationalist term, you could say, that Robert Brandom is becoming a really key reference for a lot of people who are arguing for the under a neo-rationalist umbrella. And you footnote 133, it's like a two-page footnote or something, you call that into question. And this is, I think the question is difficult insofar as I think it's pretty safe to assume that none of us here are Robert Brandom experts. Some of us may be familiar with the sort of basic premise of this, you know, trying to resolve incompatibilities of thought matched with behavior. So basically, if you come up with a new sort of knowledge, then you also have to figure out the material and behavioral articulation of a commitment based to that knowledge, especially if that knowledge is not compatible with what you knew before. And you suggest that this is not sufficient for a left accelerationist project. And if I'm not mistaken, you rather advocate for risk rationality. Is that correct? And I was just wondering if there is any way to, in any sort of relatively concise presentation for us, I mean, well, for practitioners such as us, to just to keep in mind that there are other models of reason and rationality, because I have the feeling that, you know, as you said, one of our strengths is that it's transdisciplinary. The other part is that I'm not doing all the readings that strictly philosophers are having the time to do. So often you have to kind of take a lot of those resources at face value, and it's really good when there's a dominant reference point coming in and then somebody challenges it. And so I just was wondering if you care to elaborate on this risk rationality that you feel, as I understood it in your footnote, is more adequate for our time of a transmodern horizon.
Is that Patricia,
before Soulard starts, I just want to say the number is 127, not 123.
No, 133.
133?
Yeah.
It's footnote 133.
Page 784.
Okay, anyway, got it.
You can sort out later. Oh, Christ.
Sorry.
Okay. Okay, so let me give as brief as I can background to the in terms of the art field. I'm going to go back quite a way, and then sort of just as a way to set up the discussion on risk rationality, and then I'll kind of address the question that you asked specifically. Okay, so I mean, as we all are, I'm interested in what capitalism is, power structure, blah blah blah. Okay. Doing some work in a paper, Tainted Love essay, what struck me, the art market is a real problem in terms of neoclassical economics, and any standard model of economics makes no sense whatsoever, right? Because basic things like supply and demand just don't follow the standard logic of economics. If you look at models, it's not based on labor. So labor theories of value are kind of bankrupt, or bankrupt's not kind of useless to explain the economics of the art system. So you look at all the kind of standard models, standard economic models, and sort of heterodox models and something, none of it makes sense in terms of describing how the art market works. So the art market looks totally aberrant. But through the Tainted Love essay, which I think is online through Netson and Bishop website, what I kind of proposed, I guess, it's a co-written essay, but this is my element of it, was that actually the art market is the truth of all other capitalisms. Okay, what this means is that all the standard economic models, and there's a lot of this post-2008, all the standard economic models that we use to describe capitalism and opposition to capitalism, Marx and so on, aren't actually legitimate or don't describe what they claim to describe very well. But at the same time, that's all we have. So using this notion of pricing from Nitzan and Bischler as a real description of power in the power through capital. Sorry, got an intruder in the house. So using Nitzan and Bischler's description of Nitzan's description of pricing as power. What I what I sort of thought was necessary was to think about price as the kind of the only indicator of political economy. Actually, I mean, it's the only constituent factor of political economy. It's not labor, it's not use, it's not consumption, which are the kind of three major axioms, I guess, of standard political economies, Marxist as well as neoclassical. And that's kind of what led to the ontology of finance paper. And there, what I started with was thinking about derivatives markets, partly because of 2008. But also derivatives are a way in which these objects called derivatives are priced in relationship to the future, which is not known, and profits are taken simply from price constructions. Right? It's something that's ambitious. Haven't talked about. Nitin did a paper on it recently in Toronto. It's in Montreal. But in finance, profits and capital are accrued just through pricing mechanism, and all the stuff through which they operate, like production, housing, tax, and the rest of it, are all exchangeable. It could be anything that could be used in order to extract profits. Right. So finance to me seems like a moment of capitalization. Description on the best operation of capitalism that there is, and in this, it's surprisingly close to the art field. Right, art is still too attached to a kind of commodity form in its political economy. I don't think art is really about commodity form. I think it's about ownership things which are priced. Right, so that's the kind of convergence between art and finance. So that's the kind of broad picture, which is the kind of basis for the ontology of finance paper. Now, within the finance field. The description I use to describe derivatives, I mean, I go through kind of some exploration of what they are and so on and so forth, but the kind of theoretical scheme are twofold. One is Derrida's notion of difference, in which the present is constituted by a future which makes the present irreducible to itself. Right? So the future constitutes the present, which means that it's never self-present. And that's exactly the structure of the derivative. What the price will be at the end of the contract is what determines... Well, the price of the underlying that the derivative price is based on at the end of the contract is what determines the price of the contract now. So the future constitutes the price now. So it's not about the labor that's produced of what the commodity is, which is the Marxist claim, which is a kind of historical reason for the price to be what it is. It's not about consumption, which is a kind of presentist account. It's about a future. Sorry, I'm just kind of seeing a worrying sign. Is that a PDF of this article around? There really shouldn't be. Anyway, don't read the PDF. Buy Collapse. It's very important to Robin that you buy the issue.
No, they're talking about the other PDF, not Robin's PDF.
Oh, fine. Okay, good. If you ever get a PDF of this article, destroy your computer immediately. It's like, I know it doesn't exist on the computer, but anyway. So the Derridean account of temporalities is one part of the explanation of what derivatives are and pricing and capitalism, and the other part is a Italian sociologist called Leno Esposito, who has a book called The Future of Futures, which you can get on PDF fairly easily, who describes derivatives in terms of systems theory. And there she's using Niklas Luhmann's notion of risk societies as societies which are unstable in terms of fundaments, so it belongs to kind of anti-foundationalism of post-structuralism, but which organize themselves through social norms. Social norms because, as with derivatives, the only way that you can recognize your price as a good one is to look at what other people are pricing the derivative at. Okay, with the artwork, the only way that you know what the price of an artwork should be depends on what everyone else is saying about the work and what everyone else is pricing it at. Okay, the artwork doesn't have an intrinsic price. If you do a ton of work on an artwork, it doesn't make it really more expensive than something, that's some chewing gum that somebody sticks up on the wall. Right? It's like that's not what's determining price. What's determining are a bunch of institutional operations, which is to say power. Right. So with Esposito, you have an account of how derivatives of price, which has the two factors which interest me. One is the price now depends upon the future, and that's never settled, because if you put a price on something now, depending on what you think the future is going to be, it acts as a performative, and that changes the future price, right? So it's already kind of, it's a counter-performative, in fact, right? So if you say the price of the derivative at its termination date will be $600, the fact that you take out a contract for that price and everyone sees you doing that will drive the price up or down, which means the termination price will not be $600, it will be something else. And that's how the derivatives markets work, right? It's a kind of betting without end. So if you make a bet on a horse or what the next card to come up, it changes what the wages, what the odds are on the betting, and that just continues indefinitely with derivatives. But the second point would be exactly that everyone is looking at everyone else to understand what the price should be. Okay, what that does is construct pricing as a social norm. It's a social norm which is in revision because it's always changing, but it's also a social norm which is utterly flexible and mutable because it's only socially organized in terms of, so the social norm is now, but it's with a view to a future which changes according to the construction of the norm itself, right? So it's complicated. But what it means, and this comes back to the point that Patricia was asking about brandom and neo-rationalism. So let's just park that for a minute, okay? There's a kind of rationality constructed, basically. The derivatives markets, which I think is also operating in the art markets, not the art field, not contemporary art, but in the art markets, which are way ahead of the game in this to most contemporary art, which is about the generation of prices, which are statements of institutional power, which are claimed to be predictive, but actually constitute future pricing, constitute future power, and which are always in revision because it's organized just as a bunch of social norms, right? So park that for 1 minute. What's happening in terms of neo-rationalism and the turn to brandom through people like Wolfendale, Negrestani, Brazier, somewhat but not really, and so on and so forth, those guys, is kind of play between social norms, which are understood to be oppressive, so it comes back to the earlier discussion, and rational norms. And the argument is a modernist argument based in Kant, essentially, that rational norms will generate emancipation. Okay? But rational norms, which is how we should make sense of things for there to be freedom, are not social norms, because social norms, we know, are not emancipatory, they're oppressive. All right. So what this sets up is it's kind of dialectical in a way, but not really. It's really that if we pursue rational norms, then we break social norms, including norms of what we understand the human to be, what we understand social organization to be, race, gender, class, and the rest of it. All right. So the version of reason that they're advocating is revisionary without end, so it's not Hegelian. And also it's one in which the revisions of social norms, because of the development of rational norms, I don't know, this might be a bit, basically you develop your ideas according to reason, one of which, the fundamental idea which remains, because it's no longer logical and the rest of it, is freedom. Okay. So what you're developing by developing your ideas according to reason is what freedom should be. Okay? And it's unending. There are always more freedoms to be had. And you then think about what these freedoms are, and you look at what the world is, and you think, oh, the world stinks. So this is a way in which you can provide a basis for a sense of no-sync, essentially, right? Or transformation of institutions, and understand what needs to change in what institutions in order to kind of get to this like rational freedom. So the demand for rational norms produces pressures on social norms, which transforms the social towards freedom. Right? It's an emancipatory. This is the Enlightenment, essentially, in broad terms. Okay. What's fundamental to this theoretical proposition is that reason is a system of revisions, which have traction, which remain in place. I mean, even if it's going in revision, reason still has authority over social norms. Okay, the counterexample would be, okay, you do all this, and this is actually maybe the truth of neo-rationalism. You do all this kind of thinking about what rational norms are, what free could be, blah, blah, point to reason, blah, blah, you look at the social and it totally ignores you. They don't care because their social power is different to the claims of reason. Within this revisionary neo-rationalism, the idea is that because reason is a universalism, it has traction and appeal for everyone. So this is the basis for any social program which strikes for rationalism. But within that, there's an assumption that reason has authority. Okay? And reason has authority which is not organized by social norms. It's distinct. It's a distinct authority, social norms. And because of its universalism and because of its truth as reason, the social norms will bend to the rational norms. They will be compelled beyond themselves, beyond whatever is in place now. It will change because reason has greater authority, right? And also, it belongs in a different temporality to the time of human interactions and the rest of it, to social time. So that's the neo-rationalist argument. So what I do in these footnotes, which are essentially a long article, which I'm actually hoping to turn into a series of talks, is compare these two claims around risk rationality, which as Posito derivative markets are doing, which is real power through capitalization now, against the neo-rational claim. Okay. And the argument isn't like, oh, here's a bunch of sort of philosophers with very small traction against like the massive forces of capitalism. It's an argument around principles. And the claim is that what's misunderstood by the neo-rationalists is that reason has authority over the social. And the reason they don't get it is because, as Esposito shows, especially Esposito, in the conditions of risk societies, the only norms that are in place are social norms constituted by observing one another. Okay? In relationship to future, that's set up by the act of like the derivative market or the price mechanism and so on. What that means is that any claims made by the neo-rationalists that reason will have authority over social norms is basically exactly, it misapprehends what social norms are, right? What it misapprehends is that social norms are anyway constructed through rational claims. They're not constructed through rational claims, they're organized through what Esposito calls second order observation. Okay. So it's a risk rationality. And the other issue is that to come back to the Brandom moment, the argument is that once you've deduced your rational claim, it requires a commitment in order to realize it. Okay, and your commitments are commitments towards freedom, and because they're rationally organized, they are what they are, and they persist through time. Compare that to what's happening with risk rationalities, where if you vouch something into the future, and you're looking at the effects that that has on others, but also how others are seeing you vouching for something into the future, it's a counter-performative. You can't make commitments in the same way. Okay? So both claims being made by the neo-rationalists, on the one hand, that the commitments, rational commitments, will produce social transformations because they act on social norms, because they're commitments, right? Rational commitments, and secondly, that reason has authority over the social, both of those are violated or vitiated by risk rationality. So the argument here is like, oh, do you then just, so that's the problem that's explored, and it's actually, I think, four footnotes sort of elaborate that problem out. What do you then do in that circumstance? Do you then say, let's just abandon any rationalism because all we have are these social norms and so on and so forth? Or do you kind of take the notion of risk rationality as a type of reason? And my sense is to do the second. Let's say that risk rationality has a reason, but it's not the same as the reason of neo-rationalism as it's propounded on the basis of Brandom. Okay. And what then needs to happen is to rethink rationality or reason on other terms than Brandomian ones. That's work to be done. But basically, I think the Brandomian deontological Neckstein Wolfendale axis, insofar as it's still committed to Brandom, I think this doesn't have any social traction. It misapprehends the authority of reason on the social. It's still too attached to an enlightened model, risk rationality has surpassed.
No, I really appreciate you making that clear. Just because I remember last year in the session in Berlin, there was a kind of summer school that was largely centered around this neo-rationalist camp, and that's when this kind of introduction to a lot of these Brandonian principles came to light. And one of the major critiques I had about it was not so much that I could critique the model itself, but the scalability of it. Because it makes sense in a singular version that I do something, I experience a contradiction, I change my behavior, so on and so forth. And the only way that could be scalable is this very arithmetical, is that even a word? Like basically you would just kind of add the amount of people who would experience the same thing, they change their behaviors, and then you have more. Because what I appreciate about your risk rationality is that it requires a multi-actor system because of this second-order observation, right? It's ineffectual. Yeah. Yeah. You can't by yourself enact risk rationality in a sense, right? Whereas it seems to me the other it seems to me like in your risk rationality model, you can't do it as an individual. It's like it's an embedded
not at all
activity. And the Brandonian model
you're socialized and institutionalized immediately.
Yeah. And the Brandonian model, the problem is it for me is that it's like this kind of a simplistic conscientism of like, you know, do things that don't, you know, that you wouldn't, the sort of categorical imperative. It falls into this.
I'm
simplifying it, but it seems to be unscalable, is what I'm saying. And this seems to be a real contradiction.
Be careful, Brandonism can't, in that, his beard is much bigger. No, Brandonism can't, in that, for Kant, as an individual, one could come up with like the moral imperatives and so on, right? Because it's simply the act of reason on your own judgments. Whereas for Brandon, this kind of famous "the game of giving and asking for reasons" cliche is that reason is a social process, right? So in a way, reason is a kind of collective endeavor. So this is how rational norms are tied in with the distinct to social norms, mm-hmm. but they're tied into them. Okay. So social norms transform because how to put it, one understands what rational norms are through social endeavor, so it's kind of not acting at a micro level of the individual. It's at least communal, maybe social. Okay? Mm-hmm. So it's scalable in terms you're using somewhat, but nonetheless it assumes that the rationality that people are observing is a common one, which is not about looking at one another, but an idea of reason, and that's where it's Kantian. Okay, and also that once you've come up to a rational conclusion as a community or something, that it persists, like the rational conclusion stays in place, and then you build the next step upon it, and so on and so forth, right? And that you can do as an individual, that you can do thousands and so forth.
Suhail.
So let me just finish with Patricia. Can I just finish with Patricia?
Yes.
So I think the issue isn't quite one of, I wouldn't phrase it as one of the asociality of the Brandonian model against the sociality of the expositor model. I think both are social. The question is, what's the picture of the social in each model, right? And it seems to me that the expositor model gives much more credence to the flexibility, adaptability, and chaos of social norms, because there's nothing foundational in them, right? As opposed to the Brandonian model, which assumes the authority of reason over the social, and also that reason is the binding element for the social, which is why rational norms can transform social norms. And I think the expositor model isn't just like another model. It negates the Brandonian model. Right, it's actually Lumanian rather than expositor. But also, for me, it's important to go with that because insofar as neo-rationalism seems to make any claims about capitalism, neoliberalism, as a system of oppression, how to get out of it, at least talk about the society you're living in rather than some kind of community of rational thinkers. Right? And the society we live in is one determined by capital, and the purest form of capital, or the most purist isn't quite the right term, that the least mystified form of capital, in a way, is finance. It was just kind of countersensical to the usual way that it gets adopted. And it's the least mystical because it's not saying that capital valuation depends upon labor, it depends upon use, it depends on things external to the capital, to the pricing process. Finance says capital is organized only through the pricing process. That's it, nothing else. All the rest of it is kind of paraphernalia, which gives an alibi in conventional terms for the pricing process, right? So if you're going to talk about power, and you're going to talk about reason relationship to power, at least work on the basis of how power is organized socially, in fact, right, through capitalism, which I think is risk rationality.
So, Hale, what so I was
for me, you start with the right object on which you claim to have traction.
So, Hale, there's a way to nuance your characterization of randomian thought, because I don't think, say, the way Reza uses it is identical to the way even Brandom uses it, or the way Peter Wolfendel uses it, but also temporally different, because Reza's thought used to be much more prone to risk. I remember back in 2013, or even like later on, how this notion of risk was almost built into Reza's sort of like way he talked about rationalism. But I think you're right about like this thing closing and kind of like the authority of reason taking over, and it's a very important distinction you make, actually. But I think there's a way to synthesize the two, precisely like how you said, like Esposito's like risk rationality, or your, actually, why we call it Esposito? Suhail Malik's risk rationality is not irrational, or like does not deny the authority of reason or rationality, but kind of like talks about how it actually, you know, like basically to take for reason or for a community of like philosophers to take that itself a risk. It's a risk you take when you make a claim, and this risk then falls again back into a risk economy, whatever it is. And then once you do that, then you've kind of like can't go back. Reza used to actually emphasize this kind of like any kind of like navigation towards this emancipation is a risk, and you have to either secure the risk, or the risk is either successful or a failure, and it will always have ramification for what you've done, right? But somehow this was kind of like not abandoned, but not talked about.
I mean, I don't think Reza's work that closely. So the only thing I'd sort of say around that would be that it's not simply a matter of risk. The question is, what do we mean by risk? And what Esposito, through Lumen, shows very clearly is that in our societies, and this is kind of form of advanced modernity, right? In our societies, any act is a counter-performative, right? If it's simply social norms that are produced by this second-order observation where we look at one another to understand what the right thing to... I mean, her other model is fashion, right? You look at one another in order to know what to do, and other people are looking at you to understand what they should do. So you know that your own actions are already caught up in the circuit of relationality and referentiality, which doesn't end, and that's how you act or don't act, right? So every act you do is not a risk in a predetermined field. The act that you make generates a risk for yourself and for others, which means that the notion of commitment doesn't work anymore. Okay, so what I'd want to know is whether, let me finish this and I'll come back to your question, Christina. Right. So there's a way of thinking about risks, which is you can go this way, you can go that way, it's not clear, what is the right fork in the road, we don't know, right? But in a way, the field in which you, and this comes back a bit to the Zhimyevsky quote at the beginning, the field in which you act is given to you, and your acts are risks because you don't know what the right thing to do is. This notion of risk rationality is different to that because the very fact of acting changes the field itself, okay? Your act is a risk for the field, right? Your act is a risk for the social norm in which you take, and the risk could be nothing. I mean, the risk could be like nothing changes at all. You just kind of you whatever else he's doing, right? Normal call. Or that people see what you're doing and think that you're doing the wrong. This is very much the outflow. Think that you're doing the wrong thing and everyone ditches you. Okay. Or you do just whatever you do. What you think should be done according to everyone else's diktats, and that's the wrong thing. You just don't know, right? So what's very difficult in this is that it's not clear what it is to navigate. You're not navigating in a field that preexists the act of navigation itself. Okay? So for me, at that point, navigation stops being a useful term. Because certainly the overriding sense of navigation is like...
Reza was... I mean, you're characterizing what I said even better than what I meant, but that's what I meant, and I think Reza was prone to a limited sense of these ideas, particularly that there's no field to navigate, and navigation and the risk involved in navigation constitute the field. But those things are not discussed these days by people who took the Brandomian line. So there's a way to synthesize these. That's what I'm trying to say. But I agree with you, and you know that. So I should just like let others kind of like ask you more questions.
Okay, Christina, I think had a.
I just had a corroboration for you. I was staying with a friend in New York who is recently retired from 10 years of bond trading on Wall Street. And she explained to me that the bond traders work with, in working, in developing risk management tactics, they use a principle that they call, or loosely call, the pain trade. And basically what that means is that every single risk assessment has to take into account the possible pain that it will inflict on any other party, and then that goes into the bet. I just wanted to share that because I believe that what she told me from the, as it were, the trader's floor precisely corroborates your view. That's really all I had to say.
Yeah, I guess pain there is financial pain, right? Like costs rather than sort of emotional.
It could be more than that because, I mean, it could mean an example might be if you bet that Walmart will be successful in bottling all of the water in California and selling it so that all of us in California have to buy our water from Walmart, that would have a direct pain, an indirect pain trade relative to the population that has to drink water, i.e., everyone. So there's there are levels of pain. She basically said that this entire.
Sorry. Dan, switch off your mic, I think, because I think
it's... Dan, switch off your mic.
No. Okay, sorry, Christina, okay. You were saying...
I'm not sure where I got lost here, but I'm saying that there would be... Suhail, you had said these would be financial pain, but I'm going to suggest that it's broader than that, because it really... is within there's risk assessment going on at every level. So that does mean that there's pain and has an impact on non-financial sectors as well. Or to put it another way, all sectors of existence become financially mediated. That's really all I have to say.
Yeah, I think that's right. I don't have much more to add to that. It seems to be post 2008 sort of awareness. I think the lesson to be drawn from that is the way in which two things. One, that the consequences of the trade, the bond trade. Certainly they include non-financial elements as well as part of the risk. But we have to understand that that non-financial elements are also about the profitability of the trade in the end and the direction that the market overall would want to go. Secondly, that the secondly, the point, and maybe again this would differentiate the risk rationality argument from the navigation argument. What bond traders do, what people in finance markets do, and what risk rationality involves is calculation all the time. Right? So the risk is calculated. So when you're speaking about the pain trade, it's part of a broader calculation of what price needs to be made and which bonds need to be traded. And so that calculation is numerical because it's about pricing. It's also strategic and it's also political and it's heavily socialized in finance, which I think is also there in art pricing. Okay? Which I think why art pricing is really estimated as kind of political strategy by people who aren't sort of the dealer collector circuit. What you have in pricing on the finance markets is a combination of the second order observation happening through calculation, through pricing, which is a number that's given on something. And what people are looking for is prices. They're looking at prices. The problem for me with Esposito is she turns everything into an issue of what the trader is doing. But I don't think it's really an issue about what trade. I mean, it's not like a subjectivist, personalistic thing. I think my guess is finance markets, apart from a few individuals, generally people look at what the price is, what party is making what price. Okay. So on the one hand, it's reputational. Are you working for Goldman Sachs or are you a kind of two-bit operator? And if you're a two-bit operator and you put a trade at a price, it's a very different thing to somebody from Goldman Sachs putting in the trade at that price as well, right? It's exactly how the art market works. So there's a way in which risk rationality is only about, through finance, right, is only about socialization, but socialization manifested through price and calculation, right? What this means is that the standard separation between the social and calculation or pricing or markets, which is kind of a theoretically and critically important one, gets broken down. The sociality and pricing kind of fold into one another, right? And that's a mechanism of power. So what we need to understand then is the organization of power directly at the point of pricing as a form of sociality. So I think the pain trade would be a good way to think about the sort of transition between these different terms. I think there's a much more small scale thing happening, similar to that. I think the logic is, my sense, pretty exactly the same in the art market. For me, it's therefore a mistake for people who are interested in the politics of art and what art can do politically to not think about the art market in a rigorous way, and to say that politics in art has to happen despite marketization. Right? It's a completely anachronistic notion of politics. And I think even a wrong, completely, not just anachronistic, but in principle, erroneous way of thinking about politics to exclude pricing from what political is in the name of the standard art claims around constituencies, feelings, communities, ethics, morality, and the rest of it, like Rancierian claims, essentially. I mean, now Rancierian claims. It doesn't take power seriously enough.
Yeah, I totally agree.
I'd like to come in at this because it's after two, and those states.
Sorry, an hour. So one stage, James Frank.
oh God! Yeah. Okay. I can't because I also lost the session to Mo. So, but I just
it does seem in a good flow, but I also realize it's sort of time, and I know that everyone has other commitments, so I think I am going to call it a day here, because I know that our guest has other commitments, as do I, and I'm sure everyone else does too. But it's been pretty fantastic. Patricia, I'm really glad that you did ask that question, because it sent us down a rabbit hole that we wouldn't have otherwise gone down, but there was great, and I think really useful. And
the conversation,
I recommend everyone buy that.
The conversation and question can continue on the classroom, and then people can think about this, and maybe we can address them in the next session, in the very beginning of the next session, because this was a very heavy-duty class that kind of set the philosophical kind of like ground of the rest of the seminar, I think, right, if I'm not wrong.
We expect them all to be pretty heavy-hitting, that's the plan.
I can come back if you want. If you want to follow up, I can do a little bit more time.
Thank you.
That's very kind.
All right, thanks.
Patricia, unmute.
Thank you very much, Suhail.
Thank you very much.
It's been really super great. And yeah, sorry for taking much more of your time, but I really appreciate it. So many questions.
I didn't say I was going anywhere, certainly.
Okay.
Good. My task is done.
Have a nice afternoon.
Okay, see you.
Okay, so if everyone else stays on, let me just let Suhail go. Thank you.
Thanks to everyone. And Mo, do you want to tell me how to save the sidebar?
Oh, you're muted. Mo, you're muted.
Yes, sorry, I muted myself. Yes, sorry. So basically, you just scroll up, all the way up, and then you copy, and then you paste it immediately into the classroom. That's what I usually do with classes that I run. And then it'll be there saved because I lost my session, right? And also, let's make sure everyone has the classroom link. Does everyone have a classroom link and the code to get in? If you don't, contact me on Facebook or, okay, Samil has it, and I think everybody else has it, right?
Mm-hmm. Just hang on. And where do you, okay. I can like stay on with you for a second, Mo, if you don't mind. Just I want to get it in the classroom before hanging up and losing something.
Yeah. So we can stop the broadcast now if there's no more questions or if people feel comfortable ending the broadcast. So the broadcast is about like 2 hours and a half. Okay. So I'm gonna end the broadcast. Diann and Patricia, thank you so much for your time and thank you for bringing Suhail here. This was really like the first time he discussed his collapse essay in kind of like compressed version because not everyone can read like 120 pages. So thank you much. So I'm going to end the broadcast.